The eternal quest for that one bed surface that perfectly sticks while printing and completely releases when cold. Many have tried to find it. Many have failed, but 3DQ have finally done it. Or at least that's what they claim for the Quinley system, which promises to turn your humble 3D printer into a global scale production unit by adding a network gateway that controls your printer and that it can use to cure prints, a lift kit that angles your printer so that parts can slide off the print surface once they're done, and of course, there's a special bed surface that completely releases once the parts are done. For the same job of keeping the printer running non-stop, I've previously built a super involved auto bed changer system, but this approach seems a lot simpler. Could it really be that easy? Are there any downsides to this? Does it really save you machine time? And who is today's sponsor? It's Prusa Research with printables and their Mark 3S Plus. If you're tired of buggy model sharing sites that are full of three-click designs, check out printables. It's free, it's really good, and of course, it's not Prusa exclusive. The site is constantly updated with features the community asks for, and they make sure to encourage high quality designs by running themed contests and with a reward system that lets you earn useful stuff like free Prusa Mint. And of course, Prusa also makes 3D printers, like the Mark 3S Plus. I think all I really need to tell you about that is that even though I've got much more capable machines, the Mark 3 is still the machine that I use when I just want to get stuff done. No mods, no tinkering, just using their factory-tuned slicer profiles, and it just keeps on giving. So if you're looking for a workhorse machine for a hobby or pro-level setup, check out the Mark 3S Plus, and if you're looking for a nicer model sharing site, give printables a go. So as always, disclaimer, the Quinley kit was provided to me free of charge for this review. I do not need to send it back, but no money changed hands and 3DQ had no say in this review. So let's start out with the price. What I've got installed here is the Quinley 4 Prusa Mark 3 plus the wireless hub, which totals to $548. If you skip the Rock Pi and use, for example, Octoprint with a plugin for queuing your prints, you pay $99 less, but that still makes it $450 for the Vapor bed surface, a couple of printed parts for the lift kit, and some aluminum extrusions included with that. And I'm just going to say it up front, that is outrageously expensive for what you get. But in the world of ROIs, upfront price doesn't matter as long as it provides more value than it costs. Of course, the value proposition here is that instead of having to babysit your printer and, you know, manually changing the print beds, you just load up enough filament, queue up however many prints you want, and, you know, without any manual intervention, simply come back and collect the finished parts once they're done. The core component, of course, is the Vapor bed, and it looks like it's a standard FR4 sheet with some sort of coating on it. The instructions are very adamant about never cleaning it with solvents, but only with water and soap. In the case of the Mark III, you stick it over one of your existing flex beds. You just pin the probe, if needed, and you're off to the races. You know, it would have been nice not to have to take up one of the original flex beds for this, and I ended up sticking it over one of the smooth PI sheets, which, you know, made for quite a thick overall bed assembly. But the Pinda still had no trouble reading through that entire stack up. Auto leveling works fine, it's all good. Because you're propping up and tilting the printer, you know, they also give you parts to relocate the LCD to the top of the machine, which you're mostly going to be using to swap filaments, as the idea is really to use a print host to start and manage your prints. I used it with the Rock Pi running 3DQ's host software, where you simply upload a G-code, choose how many copies you want, and what temperature to release, and the rest happens automatically. Between every print, it's also running a clearing cycle, where the head moves down all the way and kind of slides off the parts from the bed. That's also what this skirting is for that's attached to the bed and to the undercarriage, the Y-axis of the printer, to make sure that parts don't get stuck in the mechanical bits of the printer as they slide off. And most of the time, this works 100% of the time. When it does work, here's how the time savings come out. Let's assume there's someone there who can maintain the printer for 8 hours on workdays. Between that, there's 16 hours of unattended printing every day, and of course, a weekend as well. Now, manually swapping a bed and starting a new print really doesn't take any time at all. That was real time right then. But because you're most likely not going to catch the print right as it finishes. Let's say it's a 5-minute penalty for each print, but you also save some time on the heat up before the next print. Because on the Quinley, it's not like the next part starts immediately either. After every print, it has to wait and let the bed cool down by itself before it can start the clearing cycle. There's no fan or anything to help that, and because the release temperature is pretty close to ambient, that can take a while, about half an hour roughly. So I did the math for a week of printing, starting and finishing Monday morning with a couple of different 3D models. For a standard 2-hour 3D Benchy, printing each one individually, within 1 week you'd have printed about 20 when swapping manually versus 67 when printed non-stop on the Quinley. But if you do a full plate of Benchies, it's not quite that drastic anymore, because you need to leave some space in that corner in the back here where the tool head first plunges down to clear the bed. You can fit slightly fewer parts on here, and in fact you probably also don't want to print one large part that collides with that area. So the Quinley fits
14
Benchies, while a regular bed fits
24.
But because the Quinley can auto-clear, you get
6
beds worth of parts after a week, while you'll only be able to get 3 when manually clearing. So that's
84
Benchies for the Quinley versus
72
when done by hand. And lastly, with a single larger model like Uncle Jesse's skull printer at
120%.
You'd get 5 parts printed in a week by hand, and an extra one done on the weekend by the Quinley. Obviously, when you're clearing manually, you can tweak your print setup so that you're there when they finish, and you can start the next one right away. But with Quinley, you can just chuck parts towards the printer, get consistent times per part, and you won't have to babysit the machine when everything works. The great thing about using the stock surface on the printer and having profiles from the manufacturer to go with that is that all you have to do is load up your model, choose what you're trying to do, and you're going to have a pretty good time. Again, that's why I usually gravitate towards using my Prusas for most of my printing, even though I have flashier, faster, bigger printers. But I know this one is just gonna work. But once you slap something like the Quinley bed surface on it, it's a whole new puzzle to figure out. There is a table online that tells you what should work and what probably won't, but you will have to meticulously tune in every new material you use. And I don't just mean going from PLA to PETG, no, no. Every brand, and possibly even every color of the same material, requires completely new tuning. So the first prints I did were with Prusament PLA, and those required a little extra temperature to stick well enough, a little extra temperature on the bed. Next up, I printed with extruder XPTG matte in black and white, and those worked really well at stock temperatures without any changes, no problems at all. Then I switched over to extruder PLA NX2, and that stuck so well that when the clearing cycle ran, it twisted the printer's part cooling fan out of position and ripped its wires off. Printer down. I grabbed the last 5-volt fan I had off of my other Mark III and soldered it back in. I also designed this guard that would protect the parts on the tool head from this sort of abuse, and I wanted to print that in Prusament ASA, that's this guy. As you know, this part is going to be pretty close to the bed, and it didn't want it to soften and warp. On the Quinley's Vapor bed, that part just came loose after a couple of layers into the print. So I tried the exact same G-code again on a standard textured PI sheet, which worked great. Then, with the RAM shield fitted on the printer and everything back in working order, I switched back to the Vapor bed and went to basic dust filament PLA, and that immediately worked perfectly without any tweaks or issues at all. So that's what these parts were printed with. There wasn't even a temperature bump needed as with the Prusament PLA that I tried first. So with this setup, I've had the full range of experiences between parts sticking not at all, just perfectly, or way too well. With this surface that's supposed to grip well at high temperatures, but completely release when cool, you're riding a really thin razor's edge of having to get all the parameters right. Regular surfaces can just err on the side of, you know, too high adhesion, but here, even seemingly insignificant changes can have a huge impact on whether the adhesion is sufficient or not. So again, where I think this can really shine is if you have like production runs of the same part with the same material just over and over again, and you can just tune that in really well once, and then you just print with those exact same parameters for the next 1,000 parts. But if you always have new parts or new materials that you'll be printing, I think you'll actually be better off just using a regular high adhesion flex bed, skipping the tuning phase and removing the parts manually, which can actually be faster for one-off parts because you skip the mandatory half-hour cooldown phase on the Quindy. Because if you don't get the settings dialed in for every print, you're just abusing your printer. None of the components on the toolhead here were made to ram parts off of the build plate. And even with the ram guard that I added, I wouldn't want to have the toolhead crash into parts like that. The software running on the Quindy wireless hub supposedly can deal with printer crash detection triggering, which didn't work too well for me. So I ended up disabling crash detection entirely as per the instructions, which I'm told are out of date. So you're still supposed to leave it on, I guess. You're also going to have to make sure your parts don't get too heavy. With the Y-axis now having to move up a roughly 15-20 degree incline, it's sometimes already struggling to make it up on its own. And with an extra kilogram or so of filament or part attached to it, I would say you're past what I'd consider a reliable 24/7 setup. The other parts of the Quindy system is the wireless hub, which is a Rock Pi, a Wi-Fi stick, and a custom OS running on it. This was the most frustrating part of this entire review. I've had so many occasions where I need to power cycle it to get it to connect to the printer at all. It's got a queue system built in that you can add jobs to and pick how many you want, but I pretty much always had to add the job twice because the first one just disappeared without printing anything. And during this 2-day print job, apparently it rebooted in the middle of the night and left me with a half-finished print and a confused printer. All while hooked up to a UPS, that is. I really think that Octoprint with some queue plugin would be a superior solution to this in every way. Maybe if the Quindy wireless hub had some standout features, like being able to remotely connect and not just from the same network, or some sort of central management for print farms where you'd be running multiples of these. But it doesn't. It doesn't even have the basicest of features like user authentication, being able to sort files by upload date, or reprinting an already completed queue job. There's obviously lots of room for improvement still. The core of the system, the Vapor bed, when it works great. Everything built around that is still a bit rough. If your application fits that narrow beam of light where the Quindy system works out, then you're gonna have an amazing time with it. But honestly, for everyone else, you know, skip the hassle, skip the cost, and just stick with your regular bed surfaces. And that's my take on the 3DQ Quindy system. Huge thank you to all my awesome patrons and YouTube members for making it possible to run my YouTube channel like this. If you want to join in too, you can find links here and right under the video as well. But even sharing the video or just getting subscribed helps a ton too. Thank you for watching, keep on making, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye!